Guess it would help if I turned that on. How's that? Better? All right, praise the Lord. I'll try that again. Good evening, everybody. How was your day today? Were you blessed with that weather? Did you go out and maybe get a walk or something like that? That would have been a blessing. Praise the Lord. All right, a few announcements tonight, as always, before we start. I'm not going to harp on it tonight, but if you could please mute or deaden your cell phones, that would be fantastic. Another thing as well, tonight being Saturday night or Sabbath evening, we're going to have some refreshments afterwards. So if you'd like to stick around, maybe talk to each other or talk to me or talk to Pastor Wes or Jonathan, please feel free to do that. We will be back there and there will be refreshments that are served as well. So please come and join us for that. Another thing we've noticed during some of the appeals and some of the calls that we've been having, there have been some that have been requesting baptism. And that makes us so happy and joyful to know that you are choosing to serve the Lord with your life. How many of you can say amen for that? Amen. Nothing better than to serve the Lord. So for those of you that are wanting to be baptized, maybe for those of you that maybe aren't considering baptism but maybe would like to, maybe you just like to sit down on it, we're going to be having a baptismal class coming up soon. We'll give you some more information about that in a few nights. So after all that is said and done, we'd like to invite our pastor out here tonight, Pastor Wes Peppers, and we're going to have another exciting topic tonight as we explore the Lord's Word.
All right. Good evening, friends. How are you tonight? It is good to see each one of you here, and that microphone stands in the way. It was for our special music. And you know, the weather's changing, right? And it gives us the temptation to stay away, but I'm so glad that you guys are here tonight, and we're going to have a fantastic evening together. And you know, it's right now, it's the Sabbath, right? And so we are still in those sacred Sabbath hours, and so we're thankful that you're here tonight. And what a blessed time to come together to spend time in God's Word, yes? There was something else I was going to say, I'm trying to remember, but it'll probably come to me in a minute. So let's have our drawing this evening. And we have tonight a couple of gifts. I'm going to give away the Richest Caveman DVD and book. And it's going to go together. And I gave this book out before, but tonight I actually found a stack of these DVDs I had forgotten about in my office. So I'm going to put the DVD with the book. Then I have a really fantastic book called The Great Controversy. Now, actually, everyone's going to get a copy of this who comes to the meeting. I believe it's Wednesday night of next week. And so it won't be like this. This is a special one. It has a lot of pictures and different things in it. But this is a wonderful book that basically covers from the time Jesus left the earth until he comes again. And it's a fantastic book. It goes through Christian history, and it goes all the way into the prophecies of Revelation. How many of you have ever read this book before? All right, a number of you have, and it's a very, very powerful book, life-changing book, in fact. All right, so let's see what we have tonight. Our winner is Cheryl Holbrook. Cheryl, all right, would you like this one or this one? This one. All right, very good. And let's find our other winner tonight. Craig. That Craig. All right. Give them a hand this evening. All right, there you go. Would you take that one to her? Thank you so much. All right, let's see. What do we have here next?
All right, our Bible question tonight is, how do Nostradamus' prophecies agree with the Bible?
All right, I got that question, and the answer, how many of you know who Nostradamus is? How many of you have no idea? You know, okay, I found this interesting because Garrett was back there with me, and he said, what is the Bible question? I told him, and he said, who's Nostradamus?
I said,
you're too young to know. And you know, I guess it was back in, what was it, the 80s and then the 90s, something like that. Nostradamus was very popular. There was actually programs on like the Discovery Channel and the History Channel about the prophecies of Nostradamus. And supposedly it was this guy, and I even forget when he lived, several hundred years ago. And supposedly he made thousands of these predictions that would take place at the very end of time. And people thought that the events happening now were actually the events that he had predicted. And he had talked about a great leader that would die and all these different things. But the truth was that his predictions were actually very vague. They were not specific at all. And you cannot eat, they were so vague, in fact, that you can't even tie them to modern day events. I mean, it's too vague. It could be one thing, but it could also be 150 other things. Does that make sense? And so there's not any connection between Nostradamus and the prophecies of the Bible. In fact, I'll just give you a Bible verse tonight. It comes from the book of Amos. Amos is in the Old Testament. It's in those little books before the New Testament, the book of Amos, chapter 7. And if you flip too fast, you'll miss it. I'll give you a clue here. It's, you go to the book of Daniel. You all have been to Daniel multiple times. You take a right and you'll find Hosea. And then you have the book of Joel. And then the book of Amos. Okay? Amos chapter 3 and verse 7. Amos chapter 3 and verse 7. And the Bible says, "Surely the Lord God does how much? Nothing unless he reveals his secret to his servants, the prophets." And so the Bible says that God does not make any moves unless he reveals it from where? From Scripture. So there are no, Nostradamus is not applying today. Now, do you suppose at the end of time that there might be true prophets, yes or no? The Bible says, Jesus says in the last days, beware of false what? False prophets. So if he was indicating that there would be no prophets, he would just say, beware of what? Any that claims to be a prophet, right? But he says, beware of false prophets. We actually have a subject coming up to discuss about from the Bible. How do you know a true prophet from a false prophet, and what makes a prophet from the Bible? So we'll actually be discussing that. But friends, to answer the question, Nostradamus has no connection to Scripture. Are we safe to say that tonight? Amen. All right. Amos 3:7. All right. Well, thank you so much, Garrett.
I learned something tonight.
That was short and sweet tonight. I didn't preach a sermon during the Bible question time. All right. All right. Our special music this evening is by, before we do that, I'm getting ahead of myself, Michelle, hang on. Our subject, I thought I was missing something. Our upcoming schedule, tomorrow night, we'll be off. Monday night, we'll have Revelation's Temple of Glory. And what does the Bible say about this temple, and what is it? What exactly is it? You're going to find out. It may surprise you, actually, what the Bible says that it is. But don't forget, we're going to do that special baptismal class. There are some folks that have said, I'd like to be baptized, and so you can come to that class at 6:25. If you're not planning for baptism, but you'd like to come anyway, you're still welcome to come to that, 6:25. Then Tuesday night, getting ahead of bump on my button. Tuesday night we'll be off, and as usual. Then Wednesday night, the USA in Bible prophecy. What does the Bible say about the United States in prophecy? You'd be amazed, friends. We're going to do that next Wednesday. Then Thursday night, off again. Friday night, Revelation Scarlet Harlot. Revelation chapter 17, the Bible talks about this woman who sits upon a beast and she influences the whole world. Who is it? We're going to study that next Friday night. Then we'll have those baptismal classes at 6:25 p.m. All right, this evening we have a very special music tonight from my friend Michelle. Michelle is a teacher down in Kalamazoo. And she has come to bless us this evening. And actually, after the meeting tonight, she will have some CDs available for sale. We invited her to sell those. So if you enjoy the music, you'd like to grab one of those, you can pick one up on your way out. So thank you so much, Michelle, for joining us tonight.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed. His child, and forever I am redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, His child, and forever I am. I am, oh, oh, I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, His child, and forever I am. I am, oh, oh, I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King, in whose law I delight, who lovingly guideth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, His child, and forever I am. I am, oh, oh, I am redeemed.
Thank you so much. Did you enjoy that? You better be out there first in line for those CDs, amen? All right. Well, our subject this evening is Revelations Lake of Fire and the Zombie Apocalypse. What is the zombie apocalypse? We all thought that was a fantasy, didn't you? Thought it was a fairy tale. The Bible actually talks about it, and we're going to dive in tonight. It's a very serious subject, a very solemn subject. And so we're going to need extra prayer tonight. I hope you all have your study guide this evening. Do you have that? All right. Well, let's just bow our heads if you would. I'm just going to kneel. We'll ask the Lord's blessing to be with us. Father in heaven, we thank you so much, Lord, for this wonderful time we've had together. And Lord, we just ask that as we open the Word of God, that you would speak to our hearts again one more time. Lord, we're on the downward track in the seminar, Lord, but some of the very most important subjects are still yet to come. So we ask, Father, for your blessing. We ask that you would open our hearts and open our eyes to the truth. We ask, O Lord, that you would draw close to us in a very, very special way. So we long to have your presence. We long to have your Spirit. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen. You know, during World War II, Adolf Hitler was establishing the Third Reich. How many of you are familiar, remember that from world history? The Third Reich, and he wanted that Third Reich, his empire, his kingdom, his dynasty, to last for 1,000 years. And that was the goal that he had in mind when he established that entity. He developed the SS and he began to march his troops across Europe. And he wanted that dynasty to last for 1,000 years. He actually read in the scripture of a time period in Revelation chapter 20 that speaks about the 1,000 years that are in prophecy. And he actually convinced himself that his dynasty would be the one that would last for 1,000 years. Well, as history, we know, happened, did it last, yes or no? It certainly did not. And thankfully so, amen? Thankfully, we're not all speaking German today, right? Now, no offense to Pastor Jonathan, but not that it's bad to speak German, but you know what I'm saying, right? I'm digging myself in a little hole here. Germany did not succeed in that movement. But the Bible talks about another time of 1,000 years, and it is prophetic, and it is soon to happen, I believe. But in Revelation chapter 20, verse 1, the Bible says, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who was the devil and Satan, and bound him for how long, friends? Bound him for 1,000 years. And so there is this word, this phrase, this time period, 1,000 years. Now, many times people refer to this 1,000 years as the millennium. But actually, the word millennium is not used in the Bible. Doesn't mean we can't use it, but it's not mentioned in the Bible. But it comes from two Latin words, milli and annium, which means 1,000 years. But nonetheless, there is a 1,000-year time period. So we're going to study that tonight, and I think that this is going to put together some of the answers to some of the questions you may have had over the last few nights. It's going to kind of put that final piece in the puzzle from last night and Wednesday night. So question number one says, what event marks the beginning of the 1,000 years of Revelation 20? What actually happens in Revelation 20 before that takes place? We read this verse the other night, but we're going to read it again here. Revelation 19:11, John speaks and he says, "Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white," what? "A white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of," what? "The Word of God." Who is this person coming out of heaven on the white horse? It is who? It is Jesus. It is none other than Jesus. "Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." This is a picture tonight, friends, of the second coming of Jesus. He comes from heaven to take his people home, and that's the event, as we're going to find, that actually triggers the 1,000 years that we see here in Revelation chapter 20. So once you read chapter 19, if you go through chapter 19, it describes the return of Jesus in power and great glory. But then in chapter 20, verse 1, John says something. There's that first word in that text. Do you see what that first word is? What is it, everyone? Then. So then means that something was happening prior to that moment that then causes this next thing to happen. Does that make sense? Then is a hinge word. Then I saw. So he saw the second coming of Jesus, and then he saw an angel come down from heaven and bind Satan for 1,000 years. So what event is it, friends, that triggers that event, the 1,000 years? What is it? It is the second coming of Jesus. All right, that should be question number two. It says, what else takes place at the second coming of Jesus at the beginning of the 1,000 years? So let me just ask this one more time to make sure we're all clear. When does the 1,000 years of Revelation chapter 20, when does that begin? When Jesus returns to the earth. Is everybody clear on that so far? All right. Should be number two. What else takes place at the second coming of Jesus at the beginning of the 1,000 years? Revelation 20, verse 6 says, "Blessed and holy is he who has part in which resurrection?" The first resurrection. So if there is a first resurrection, there must be by default a what, friends? A second resurrection, right? So the Bible says, he that is part of the first resurrection is blessed. And over such, the second death has how much power? Has no power. "But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him for a" what? "For 1,000 years," the Bible says. So Scripture tells us that when Jesus comes, there is a resurrection, and those people go with Christ, and those are the ones that are saved. They go with Christ back to heaven, and they reign with Him for 1,000 years. Now, does that make sense? Yes or no? It's pretty easy, isn't it? So if the saints reign with Christ, what must take place before that can happen? A what? A resurrection. And the Bible says that that first resurrection takes place at that time. Jesus said in John 5:28, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear His voice and come forth, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation." So Jesus actually speaks about in the Gospels of how many resurrections? 2 resurrections. There is the first one, which is the resurrection of life. There is the second one, which is the resurrection of condemnation. And they happen actually at 2 different times. Does that make sense? Now, this is a no-brainer tonight. Which resurrection do you want to be a part of if you should pass before Jesus comes? We all want to be a part of which one? The first one, right? Amen? So we want to be a part of that resurrection of life. And that is the first resurrection, which takes place when Jesus comes. So when does it happen? When Jesus comes. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, "For the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a what? Shout, the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." So this passage in 1 Thessalonians 4:16 corresponds with the verse in Revelation 20:6. It is the same event, yes? When it says the Lord will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, that's speaking about Revelation 19. Same event, okay? That's how Scripture connects itself. Same event tonight. And that is the resurrection of life. What a joy that's going to be, amen? Those cemeteries all around the world that are full of sadness and darkness and sorrow, those cemeteries will be the happiest place on earth when Jesus comes. There'll be people by the thousands that will rise up in the resurrection to join Jesus in the air. Graves will be popping open all over planet Earth. But question number 3, what happens to the wicked at this time? We kind of answered this the other night. 2 Thessalonians 1:9, the Bible says, "These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the power of His glory." And whom the 2 Thessalonians 2:8, "whom the Lord will consume with the breath of His mouth and destroy with the brightness of His coming." So what happens, friends, to the wicked who are left behind when Jesus comes? We know this from the other night. Do they continue living on for 7 years or 5 years or however long? Yes or no? They don't. They are what, friends? They are destroyed by the brightness of His coming. Jeremiah 25:33 says, "And at that day," speaking about the coming of Jesus, "the slain of the Lord shall be from one end of the earth even to the other end of the earth." Do you think tonight, friends, that that breaks the heart of God? What do you think? When He has to come back and He makes an end to sin, He destroys, He's coming back to take His people, and the Bible tells us that He's not willing that any should perish, but that how many should come to repentance? But that all should come to repentance and be saved. So it breaks the Lord's heart when He comes back, and there are people who are still rebellious against Him, even though He's offered them the free gift of His salvation. Tonight, friends, please, please, please do not be one of those people. But cling to Him, cling to His truth, cling to His word, and be saved. Amen? Cling to Jesus tonight. So what are the events at Jesus' coming? The believers will be resurrected, according to the Bible. We've looked up all these passages. Believers receive immortality, not at death, but at the second coming. We saw that last night from 1 Corinthians 15:51-53. The wicked living will be destroyed. They will be consumed by the brightness of His coming. The wicked dead actually remain in their graves. They remain in their graves, Revelation 20:5. The believers ascend to heaven with Christ, and then they reign with Him there for how long? For 1,000 years. Now, does that seem pretty clear from Scripture so far? Pretty straightforward, right? It's a pretty straightforward thing. There will be four classes of people when Jesus returns, according to the Bible. There are the righteous living, who will be changed in the twinkling of an eye. There will be the righteous dead, who resurrect when the trumpet sounds. There will be the wicked living that will be slain by the brightness of his coming, and there will be the wicked dead that will stay in the grave until the 1,000 years are finished. So really two categories, four classes. There are the saved and the lost. You want to be saved tonight? We got to look to the Lord Jesus, amen? It's the only way, it's the only way. So in Revelation, there are many questions that people ask about this. What happens after on earth after Jesus comes? What's the condition of the earth? What happens to Satan? When does God make the earth new? Is there anyone alive on the earth during the 1,000 years? Let's answer these questions tonight from the Bible. Number four, what happens to Satan and what is the condition of the earth during the 1,000 years after Jesus comes? What happens after Jesus comes? You remember what the Bible said in Revelation 20, verse 1? He said, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven." This is our key verse for the whole night, right? We keep coming back to it. "Having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. So the question tonight is, what are those chains that bind Satan? Does an angel come down from heaven with this big logger chain, and he grabs Satan by the back of the neck, and he drags him kicking and screaming, and he ties him up with that chain and says, "There, now you just sit right there for 1,000 years, you bad boy"? You think that's kind of how it's going to be? What do you think? I don't think so, friends. That would take a mighty big chain to contain the greatest angel, right? The mightiest angel that God ever created. So what are these chains? Do you think we could find somewhere from Scripture that talks about it that'll help us understand it more, yes or no? We find other passages from the Bible. In the book of 2 Peter, chapter 2, and verse 4, notice what we find. It says, "For if God did not spare the angels who sinned," so who are those? Those are Satan and his angels, right? About how many went with them from heaven? How many? About a third, right? "If God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell." Now that word hell is actually in the Greek the word, I believe it's abustos, which means the pit, and I'll come back to that here in just a little bit. "And delivered them into chains of" what, friends? "Chains of darkness," the Bible says, "to be reserved for" what? So our judgment. So these chains are actually chains, not a literal metal chain, but it's chains of what? Chains of darkness. And so we're going to actually come back to that, and we're going to look at some other passages that will help us explain more specifically what those chains are. But what about the earth? What happens at the earth during that time, to answer the other half of our question? He says that "I saw an angel coming down having the key to the," and notice that word, that phrase, the what? The bottomless pit. Now that word in Greek is the word abusos, which actually means abyss. And that word abusos, the literal translative phrase would be without form and void. Does that make sense? Now think about a time in the earth when the earth was also without form and void. What's that phrase? We know that phrase, don't we? Where was that from? It's from creation in Genesis, right? So the Bible actually uses the word without form and void to describe this abusos, or this abyss, okay? Now I'm going to show you a passage from the book of Jeremiah, which is actually, it is in the Old Testament, but it actually is a prophecy about the future. It has not even happened yet, okay? It says in chapter 4, verse 23, he says, "I beheld the earth, and indeed it was..." Guess what? "Without form and void. And the heavens, they had no light." So if you just read that verse only, it sounds like what time period? Creation, right? But guess what? It's actually not creation, and here's why. If you keep reading, you find out. Look at verse 24. He says, I beheld the mountains, and indeed they trembled, and all the hills moved back and forth. Then notice verse 25, I beheld, and indeed there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens had fled. So let me ask you a question. Were there birds when the earth was out, without form and void at creation? Yes or no? There weren't, were they? But notice this, the next couple verses give us the clue. I beheld, and indeed the fruitful land was a what? Wilderness. The earth, when it was without form and void at creation, was never a fruitful land. It had always been without form and void until the Lord created a fruitful land, right? And then he says, and all its cities were broken down at the what? At the presence of the Lord by his fierce anger. And so the Bible speaks about the earth becoming without form and void at what event? The second coming of Jesus. Because Jesus comes, and at his presence, the mountains melt, the hills wave back and forth, the birds of heaven fled, there was no man, the cities are broken down, and the Lord basically makes an absolute desolation to the earth when he comes. And don't miss this. The earth becomes exactly, pretty much, as it was at the second coming of Jesus. The earth becomes as it was before he created, without form and void. God destroys everything. Jesus destroys everything when he comes back. Then in verse 27, but notice this. This is very interesting, friends. It says, for thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be desolate, yet I will not make a full end. So when Jesus comes back and everything's destroyed, is there going to be a complete full end? Yes or no? No. Why? Because after the 1,000 years, that's actually when the full end will come, as we're going to see in the Bible. And then he says, remember this verse again, Jeremiah 25, verse 33, and at that day the slain of the Lord shall be from one end of the earth even to the other end of the earth. So the righteous go to heaven with Jesus, but the wicked are left behind laying dead upon the earth, as we saw. This verse, verse 33, says, they shall not be lamented or gathered or buried. They shall become refuse on the ground. Why is it that they are not lamented for, gathered or buried? Why? Because there's no one there to what? There's no one there to bury them, right? They just die when Jesus comes, and they're just laying upon the earth, and they become refuse, or like a, I don't know how you describe that. They just begin to rot. They're just rotting upon the earth. So the earth is utterly desolate. So is there anyone alive on earth during the millennium? Yes or no? No, according to the Bible, there's not. Now, there's a very popular teaching today in some circles that during that 1,000 years, everybody's living on the earth, and the righteous are teaching the wicked about the Lord, and they're showing them all these things, and they're living. I have no idea, friends, where that comes from. I don't know how that's substantiated in Scripture. If you have believed that before, maybe you can show me that. But friends, the Bible is very clear that during the 1,000 years, those people are dead upon the earth. The righteous are in heaven. The wicked are slain upon the earth. There's no one here during that time period. So the answer would be no. No one is left alive. So think about this. Let me back up here, so I don't want you to read ahead of me. You always do that, and then I go on, and they say, "Well, I don't remember what he said," because you were reading ahead. All right. So I'll take that temptation away from you. All right. So when Jesus comes, the wicked are slain. Righteous go to heaven with him, but Satan is left upon the earth. And those chains that bind him, the Bible said, were chains of circumstance. Now, let me ask you tonight, since Satan was cast to the earth from heaven, what has he been doing to humanity? What's his obsession, essentially? He's obsessed with what? Deceiving humanity, tempting them to sin, and seeking after our complete destruction, right? He wants to destroy us. he wants to try to make the character of God, make God look like a tyrant, and he's doing everything he can to destroy God's image and God's remembrance from our minds, right? So that's all he's been doing for thousands of years. And then all of a sudden, guess what? Righteous are in heaven, the wicked are slain, and he's left for 1,000 years to sit upon the earth in complete destruction. And he is bound. Why is he bound? It's literally a chain of circumstance, because he has how many people to tempt? No one to tempt. He's there by himself, in his other angels. And essentially, it's like the devil's time out. You know, when you give a kid a time out, God says, you know what? You thought that your way was better than my way. You thought that you could be a better ruler than me. You thought that your path was going to lead to true freedom. But this destruction is actually the fruit of your government. And now you're going to sit upon the earth and you're going to look at it for 1,000 years to consider what your ways, the selfish nature, brings humanity and everyone that it touches to. Sin does never pays, does it? Sin is always a bad direction. It is self-destructive. And the devil is left to look upon all the chaos that he has brought upon planet Earth. Now, you would think, friends, that that might, I mean, you would think if he was in a normal mind, that that might do him some good, right? You think maybe he might reconsider, but do you think he will? He's not going to do it, and we're going to find that to be true from the Bible. So the chain that binds the devil to the earth is a chain of circumstance, because there is no one here to deceive anymore. The wicked are dead, and the righteous are in heaven. So the Bible talks about those chains of darkness, and now he is going to be reserved for what, friends? Reserved for judgment. All right, question number 5, what happens to the righteous who are saved? What will they be doing? Well, where are they, friends? They are where? They are in heaven. Amen, yes? And verse 26 says that they're resurrected and they will reign with Christ for 1,000 years. But what exactly are they doing? I mean, are we just up there sitting on thrones for 1,000 years and just waving our scepters and just kind of having a good old time? What exactly is taking place there? And this is where it gets pretty powerful, pretty profound. In verse 4, it says, "And I saw thrones, and they sat on them." And then notice this. Judgment was committed to who? To them. Now, what judgment is committed to the people who are in heaven? Is there a judgment needed to decide who's saved and who's lost? What do you think? No, because that's already been decided, right? Jesus has already come back. That's already been decided. So the judgment is not to decide who's saved and lost. Besides, whose job is that anyway? It's not ours, but it's whose? It's God's job, right? So that's not the judgment. So it must be a different kind of judgment. Well, Revelation 20 doesn't actually specifically tell us what that judgment is, but there is another couple passages that will tell us what it is. Are you ready to see those tonight? All right, look at this. Revelation 20 verse 12 says, "And the books were opened." But what is the judgment committed to them? And who or what will be judged? What exactly is this judgment? In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2, Paul makes a very interesting statement. He says, "Do you not know that the saints will judge what? The world." Well, once again, how is that judgment? What exactly is that judgment that the saints are doing? When it says that they will judge the world, what exactly is that? Well, we look at another verse, and it actually tells us very specifically. So this verse here is connected to Revelation chapter 20. If you look in 1 Corinthians 4 verse 5, he says, "Therefore, judge how much? Nothing before when?" Before the time. And what time is he referring to? Until the what? Until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the hearts, then each one's praise will come from who? come from God. Now, this verse is very, very powerful because it gives us insight into Revelation chapter 20, believe it or not. Who would have thought that 1 Corinthians would be connected to Revelation? But you remember what we said, friends? We have to search the whole Bible and find out which passages speak on the same subject, bring them all together, and then we get a complete picture, right? Remember we said that, yes? You guys with me tonight? All right. So, let's go through this verse again. He says, therefore, judge nothing. He says, first, don't you know the saints will judge the world? Then he says, therefore, judge nothing before the time. Before the time. Which time is that? When the Lord comes. Is that phrase, until the Lord comes, does that put us in instant context with Revelation chapter 19 and 20, yes or no? It does, doesn't it? Brings us into instant context with that chapter. And he says, when the Lord comes, he will both bring to light the what? The hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the what? Of the hearts. That's very interesting. Isn't that a powerful text, friends? Very powerful. And he says, then each one's what? Praise will come from who? From God. So let me just paint this scenario for you. Jesus returns to the earth. He calls all of his people. You all go there, you're all up in heaven, and Jesus calls you and you meet him in the clouds of heaven and the clouds of the air. He takes you back to the celestial city, wherever that is, out there. And you're there and you're rejoicing and you're walking by the tree of life and you're there beside the river and you're speaking to all the patriarchs and you're looking around and, oh, there's Sister Diane and there's Sister Sukrit Das and there's Sister Betty Abrams and you're just embracing each other and everyone's having a grand old reunion, amen? And then you're looking and you say, well, guess what? You know, I don't see Grandma Maybelle here. She's got to be here. So where's my grandma, right? Everybody knows that Grandma Maybelle was a saint. She loved the Lord Jesus, and she went to church every week. She paid her tithe, and she went to the classes, and every time the church doors were open, she was there. But where is she? I got to find her. There's a lot of people here. Maybe she's over there, or maybe she's over here. And so I look around, and guess what? Grandma Maybelle's not there. What? How can this be? How can this be? God, maybe is she somewhere else? Maybe there's another. And God just looks and he says, I'm sorry. But Grandma Maybelle, she didn't make it. And you say, but Lord, surely there's some kind of mistake here tonight, today. And he says, no. Now just suppose tonight that we get there when Grandma Maybelle's not there. You remember Satan's accusations, right? What is Satan saying about the character of God? He is unfair. He is unjust. And Satan's down there on the earth waiting judgment, right? God will cheat you. He'll deceive you, and et cetera, et cetera. And God just smiles. And there's like this little twinkle in his tooth. And he says, just trust me. Think about that. Now, I believe that each of us love God enough that we could probably swallow hard and say, okay, God, I trust you. How many of you think you could trust God? But how many of you would be sitting here thinking, but why, but why, but why? You remember, friends, when we go to heaven, God does not wipe away our memories. We are still free-thinking agents who understand what's going on. God invites us to think. He says, come, let us reason together, right? Says the Lord. We are thinking human beings. And listen, Satan is ready to attack the character of God. And so what exactly is the purpose of this 1,000 years? It is for us who are saved to review the books, to check the records, and understand why those who are not there are not there. Does that make sense, yes or no? The Bible says, once again, he says that when the Lord comes, which marks the beginning of 1,000 years, he says that he will bring both to light the hidden things of darkness. So when we say, Lord, why is Grandma Maybell not there? Listen, friends, when God brings us to heaven, even though we trust and believe in God on this earth, Satan has so attempted to malign the character of God. How many of you have had bad things happen to you in this life, and even though you're a solid Christian, you love the Lord Jesus, you still wonder, why, Lord, did this happen to me? How many of you have that happen, right? And the Lord is, during that time, he's going to clear up all those questions about why did this happen and why did that happen, and all the questions and the doubts that we've had. He's going to clear all those things up, you understand? Not just for us, but for those who we thought should be there but aren't. And when we ask the question, Lord, where's Grandma Maybell? God's going to say, go check the books. And when we go check the books, there will be the record of Grandma Maybell's life. And there will be, it doesn't say he will bring to light the things of darkness. It says he will bring to light the what, friends? The hidden things of darkness. And so there may be things, there may have been things in Grandma Maybell's life that she never told anybody about. And she might have been one of those H words. You know what I'm talking about? What's that H word, friends? She might have been a hypocrite. Are you with me? But nobody ever knew, but the God of heaven knew. And he pled with her time after time. Every week she came to church and he spoke through that preacher and he pleaded with her to surrender her life. And she was all about good works, but she wasn't about a changed heart. And she would not surrender her heart to the Lord Jesus. And she died lost in her sins, even though she had done all these things. And you know, friends, there'll be people that are lost who had never missed a day of church in their life. The Bible says it. There'll be people that'll be lost, Matthew chapter 25, who worked miracles in Jesus' name. They'll be lost. And God wants us to understand why. So God, during this 1,000 years, he becomes transparent to every single one of us. Every question we have, he is going to answer. And do you know why, friends? Because at the end of that 1,000 years, he will bring final judgment upon the lost. And in a sense, he wants us to be okay with it. Does that make sense? Now think about that. Now I don't want to be too graphic or too harsh, and I don't want to scare anybody, but that person who's going to be outside of that city at the end of time, who's going to be lost, might be your spouse, might be your child, might be your parent. I don't know who it'll be. But God wants us to understand that his character is just and righteous when he brings judgment upon the wicked. So he will say to us, go check the books and see if I did not do everything possible to save that person. And because they are lost because of their own choice. But I gave them every opportunity that I could. But they have chosen this path. And then, notice what it says. He will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the hearts. What was in the heart of those people, God will bring it to our understanding. And we will know why the lost were lost. And then it says, then each one's what? Praise will come from God. And so when we understand the true character of God in his dealings with those who are lost, then we can say, glory be to God. His ways are just. He is the great God of the universe. And you are just and holy in all your ways, O Lord God. And so even when God has to bring those that are lost, even if it's close to someone we know, we will trust the judgment of God, because not just because we won't be walking by faith anymore, we'll be walking by what? By evidence. By evidence. And he will show us all the evidence for his goodness and his justice. How many of you can say praise be to God? You see, friends, God can't reveal all that to us now because our poor, finite minds and hearts just can't handle it. We can't handle that much overwhelming, but God deals with it on a daily basis. So if, as I said before, if anyone has suffered through this whole thing, it's who? Suffered the most, it's who? It's God himself, because he bears the weight of that burden day after day after day. And all the questions, all the accusations from Satan to Christ, all the things that he has said, all the ways he's attacked him and caused doubt and questionings, even in the minds of the angels, a third of them, all those things will then be silenced. And God's revelation of his character and the revelation of his love will be seen by all. Nothing will be hidden anymore at that point. How many can say amen to the God of heaven? That is what he will do. So the events during the millennium, the righteous will be in heaven, the wicked remain dead, the Satan and his angels are bound on the earth, and the earth remains desolate. How many of you can say tonight, God is good? He's going to answer every question. He's going to make every wrong right. Amen. We just have to be patient. Revelation 14:12, here is the patience of the saints, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. What events transpire after the 1,000 years of judgment that triggers the final battle of Armageddon? So we have that 1,000 years of spending that time with God in heaven. What happens at the end of that time period? The Bible says, blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. That has already taken place. Now it's time for the what? For the second resurrection. So this first resurrection was at the beginning of 1,000 years, and Jesus talks about the resurrection of life, but then he talks about the resurrection of condemnation, right? John chapter 5, verse 25. Daniel also says the same thing. Many sleep in the dust, some shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to everlasting shame and contempt. So now, friends, we don't just have the resurrection of life, but now we have the resurrection of what? Of damnation or condemnation. So now's that time. Here's where it is. Revelation 20, verse 5. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were what? Finished. So the second resurrection, the resurrection of damnation or condemnation, takes place at the end of the 1,000 years. And this, my friends, is Revelation's zombie apocalypse. Those people who are dead upon the world are coming out of their graves with the same bodies that they had when they went into the grave. Their hearts are still in the same condition. Their hearts are unchanged. They went into the grave rebelling against God, and they come out of the grave rebelling against God. Does that make sense? And so their hearts are unchanged in their resurrection. They come out with a determination to rebel against God. You know, it's very interesting that we see these movies and these television programs that are dealing with zombie apocalypses. How many of you know what I'm talking about? You have one of the famous ones right now. It's on like, I don't know how many seasons. I haven't watched it at all, but The Walking Dead. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Friends, don't watch that stuff. That stuff is just deceitful. It's just nasty. Nasty. And it is not God's ideal for people that are on their way to heaven. Amen? It is not his ideal for you tonight. And so that program, but somebody was telling me, somebody who does watch it, was telling me a line that one of the guys said to another guy. They were looking out and they saw this horde of zombies coming at them. And the one guy says to the other guy, I know the Bible talks about a resurrection of the dead, a zombie apocalypse. He says, but I didn't know that God had this in mind. Isn't that interesting, friends, that these kind of programs, if you don't, please don't watch them, but, and I don't watch them, but I used to watch them, and I see clips here and there But it's interesting that these shows actually put biblical phrases and biblical lines in their movies. Why is it, I believe tonight, that Satan is preparing the world for this event through movies and television and these different things that we see in the entertainment world? I believe Satan is preparing the world. He's conditioning those that are going to be lost for this event. Are you with me? And when they have it, they may even think they're in a TV. I don't know. But it's not God's idea. And so that is what happens. The Bible says in Revelation 20, verse 7, now when the 1,000 years have what? Expired, Satan will be what? Released from his prison. Why is he released? Because now there are what? People on the earth to tempt once again. Are you guys asleep or are you just not? You connected here? You plugged in? All right, good. Good, good. So he's released from his prison, and it says, and he will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, who number as the sand, as the sea. And so the Bible says they come together with like Gog and Magog. And so all these people, every single person that's ever lived, will be resurrected who are lost. Now, I'm not their judge, but I would guess Adolf Hitler will be there. Napoleon Bonaparte will be there. Hannibal Lecter will be there. Those kind of people, famous people from history, they'll all be there. Every person that's ever lived will either be on the inside of that city or on the outside of that city. Those who are inside the city are secure with Christ. Those who are outside the city are lost. Every person that's ever lived in the history of this world, Adam and Eve, they'll be there. Noah, he'll be there. Moses, he'll be there. Peter, James, and John, all the apostles, they'll be there. Judas, he'll be there. You and I will be there. We will all stand before the great throne of God and give an account. Think about it. How is the devil released from his prison? What event triggers this? The rest of the dead did not live until the 1,000 years are finished. He was released because he now has the whole earth to deceive one more time in one final battle for God's throne. This, my friends, is the battle of Armageddon, the final battle for the throne of God at the very end of time. Are you with me? It's not some war over in Jerusalem. It's right here on this earth, right here on this earth. Well, Jerusalem is on the earth, but this is the battle. John says, I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepares a bride adorned for her husband. And we know that this city comes down at that time because it says that the wicked go up on the breadth of the earth and surround the camp of the saints and the beloved city. So when Satan and his hosts are come about, there is the city of God, the New Jerusalem, sitting there. And Satan and his crew surround that city. And what do you think Satan wants to do, friends? He wants to take it. He wants to rip God off of his throne, just like he's always wanted to do. And this is his final attempt. Do you suppose that those who are inside the city are outnumbered or are outnumbered? They are outnumbered, aren't they? The people outside are like the sand of the sea, and Satan uses his last attempt to try to overthrow them. And then the Bible says, right following that, as they get ready to make their attack upon the city, they surround the city. I don't know exactly how it's going to be. We don't know, but I can just imagine that they're all formed in these, probably in these units, and they're organized, and they're ready to just come down and take that city at Satan's command. But guess what happens right before? As they begin to make their descent, a throne rises up above the city. It says, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away. It's the face of Almighty God. And every human that's ever lived will see it. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were open. The same books that the righteous searched in heaven, during the 1,000 years are the same books that are opened to the wicked, and the same thing that God showed the righteous over the 1,000 years, he now shows to the wicked in just a few moments of time. He reveals to them the sacrifice that he made for them on the cross of Calvary. He reveals to them time and time again the conviction that was in their hearts to surrender their lives to him, to give him everything. He reminds them of the tokens of his love that he sent them over and over and over again to remind them that he cared for them, that he had not forsaken them, even though they were going through a very difficult time. He sent them all the reminders of the time the preacher stood and preached his heart out, and they were convicted of sin and would not respond to the call. He reveals to them all the times that he sent people into their life to witness to them, to share Christ with them. He shows them everything and how they all rejected it every time. And now, because of their own choice, they are outside the city, deceived by Satan for the last time. And now the mighty God reveals it to them. I'm sure his heart is breaking as he does it. And final judgment must come. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, eternal death. Though the heart of God breaks, he must do it, because he must put an end to sin in the universe. He must cleanse the universe of the evil, destructive effects of sin and cleanse it. He did it once by water in the days of Noah. And in the last days, he does it by fire to cleanse and purge that sin and get rid of it. And the Bible says a book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to their works by the things which are written in the books. And so they thought they would take the city, but now they find themselves outside of it. And once that judgment is finished, the scripture says, fire comes down from God out of heaven, and what? Devours them. Now, friends, listen. Do you remember the verse? And it's slipping my mind at the second, but I think it's in Philippians, or one of those small books by Paul, that says, at the name of Jesus, every what? Knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is what? Is Lord. That verse will find its fulfillment on that day. Are you with me? Why? Because every human being will be there. And do you suppose now, friends, now just think about this, they are free-thinking individuals still, the lost. Do you suppose now that God sits upon his throne and takes his finger and he goes like this, and as he pushes his finger down, they're fighting it, but they're going down to their knees. And then he moves his hand and they speak the word. Do you suppose that he's doing that contrary to their will, yes or no? Not at all, friends. When the books are opened, when everything is revealed, they will bow the knee of their own free will and confess that God is just, God is righteous, God is holy in his dealings with them. And even Satan himself, because the Bible says every knee will bow. But listen, friends, the confession that they give, this is very important to understand. Somebody might ask, well, if they do that, then why doesn't God just let them on in then? Right? Because they've confessed. There's a difference between a confession of admittance and a confession of repentance. Are you with me? They will admit because they will see it and they will acknowledge that God is righteous and he is just, but that confession is not one from the heart. It is from the mind, and it does not change their characters. So God cannot let them in the gates. If he could, he would. Amen? But their characters remain unchanged. And if God were to let them in, they would be just as rebellious as they always have. They are beyond repentance at that point. Does that make sense? It's a confession of admittance, not repentance. So So do you think tonight, friends, that God's character will be justified, yes or no? It'll be justified. The events at the end of the millennium, the Christ and saints and the city descend, the wicked dead are raised, Satan is loosed, the last judgment takes place, the great white throne judgment, Satan and sinners are destroyed, and the earth is cleansed and renewed. I put this on a little chart for you. Remember way back when, like night number 5, we talked about the 2,300-day prophecy. How many of you remember that? And we studied that, and it ended in the year what? 1844. And we said that the day of judgment is what? Begun. And God is searching the books, and He's preparing people for His soon return, right? It's the pre-Advent judgment that's taking place in heaven. We saw that. Then we have the second coming of Jesus, which begins the 1,000 years. And then you have the 1,000 years in which the judgment is given to the saints, the wicked are slain on the earth, and the devil is bound to the earth. Then at the end of the 1,000 years, you have the wicked raised, the battle of Armageddon, the great white throne judgment, the final destruction of the wicked, and then God restores the earth. Does that make sense, yes or no? There it is on a timeline for you. If you want that, I'll print it for you. It's not your notes, I think, but I can give that to you. And God finally makes an end of what? An end of sin. Well, that raises a couple of questions tonight, and we're going to cover these quickly. It seems like time's out, but it's really not. It's not even 8 o'clock yet, okay? We got till 8:15. But questions about hell. What are these questions that comes up? When does hell occur? Many people think, well, hell happens when you die, but we learned last night, is that what happens, yes or no? No, not from the Bible. Number 2, is hell a hot spot in the center of the earth burning right now? Number 3, what is the fate of the wicked? And number 4, how long does hellfire last? When you put these questions in the context of the book of Revelation, you begin to get some very interesting answers. Number 7, when, friends, does hell occur? Well, Jesus actually tells a parable. But before we get to that parable, there was this interesting story in the news recently. Not recently, it was a number of years ago. How many of you ever see the tabloid papers? And the story, I won't ask if you read them, just if you see them, right? Okay. And there was this man who thought that he had actually drilled into the gates of hell. This was a story in there. This is the man, right here he is, Dr. Azako. He says, as a communist, I don't believe in heaven or the Bible, but as a scientist, I now believe in hell, he said. Needless to say, we were shocked only to make such a discovery, but we know what we saw and what we heard, and we are absolutely convinced that we drilled through the gates of hell. This is what he believes. He says, the drill suddenly began to rotate wildly, indicating that we had reached a large empty pocket or cavern. Temperature sensors showed a dramatic increase in heat to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Pretty hot. We lowered a microphone designed to detect the sounds of the plate movements down in the shaft. But instead of plate movements, we heard a human voice screaming in pain. At first, we thought the sound was coming from our own equipment, but when we made adjustments, our worst suspicions were confirmed. The screams weren't those of a single human, but the screams of millions of humans. Now, friends, I don't know if we can believe anything from the tabloids, right? But that was the story. So let's see from the Bible if it can be true or not. Can we do that? Can we check it to the Bible? In Matthew chapter 13, you go home and read the whole chapter, but Jesus tells a story of, he tells a parable of a sower. How many of you know that story? And that man sows the seed in his field, and as he sows his good seed, his workers come to him, and they notice that there are not only the good seed now sprouting, but also what? But also tares. Tares are weeds, right? He says there's now weeds there, and they ask him, how did this happen? And his response was, in verse 28, it says, he said to them, a what? An enemy has done this. Now, if you go on, he says, the servants said to him, do you want us to then go and gather them up? But he said, no, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the what? Uproot the wheat with them. He said, let them both grow together till the what? Till the harvest. And then he goes on and says, and we'll gather them up, and the good wheat we'll put in the barn, and the tares we'll throw into the fire, right? How many of you know this parable, right? Yeah? Then, later on, his disciples actually come back to him, and they say, explain to us the meaning of the parable. Okay? So Jesus begins to explain it to them, and he explains it in verse 37 to 39. He says, he who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seeds are the sons of the kingdom, but the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sows them is the devil. Then he says, notice what he says here. He says, the harvest is the what? The end of the world. That's very interesting. And the reapers are the angels. As the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be for every person when they die. Is that what he says? Doesn't say that, does he? He says, so it will be at the end of this what, friends? The end of this world, Jesus says. So Jesus plainly says that hell, or when the hell takes place, it takes place when, friends? At the what? At the end of this world. Jesus is very plain, very simple, very clear. Yes or no? So tonight, friends, is anyone burning in hell tonight? What do you think? According to Jesus, no. Right there in the Gospels, you go back and read the whole thing, you'll find it to be true. Jesus said that hell doesn't take place at death. It takes place at the end of the world. So the Bible says, according to the words of Jesus, the wicked will be burned in the future after the 1,000 years at the end of time. No one is in hell right now. Think about this for just a minute. If when we die, we go to hell, and then we burn forever and ever, Cain, who killed his brother, Seth was his replacement. When he killed, it didn't sound right when I said it. I said, no, that's not right. When he killed Abel, he went off and did his own thing, and the Bible doesn't record if he killed any other people, but let's just suppose that Abel's the only one that he killed, and he dies, and then he goes to hell, and he's just been burning, 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 right? Just been burning for thousands of years. Then you come down to the 1940s, 30s and 40s, and you have Adolf Hitler, who killed how many? We don't know how many, but millions, right? And then he dies and he goes to hell. He's down there beside Cain. They're both burning. They're both burning. Let's just suppose tonight that they burn for all eternity. So you're telling me tonight that one man is burning much longer for killing one man than the other guy who killed millions. Now, does that sound right? What do you think? Doesn't seem to sound right, does it? Is God that kind of a person? What do you think? I don't think he's that kind of a person. Now, there are some verses where people use to say this, and I'll go over those in the Q&A time. But when you look at the plain teaching of the Bible from A to Z, beginning to end, it doesn't begin to add up. Notice this verse in 2 Peter 3, verse 7. He says, but the heavens and the earth, which are now what? What is that next word? Now preserved by the same word, he says, are reserved for what? Fire on the day of judgment. So Peter actually says that the earth is reserved for what? Fire on the day of judgment. The day of judgment being that day at the end of the 1,000 years. Does that make sense? So Peter says that the earth, which would include the people in it, are reserved for fire. Doesn't say it's on fire now. He said it's reserved for judgment and the perdition of ungodly men. So tonight, friends, we learned this last night. If you weren't here last night, I'll be happy to get you a CD. But tonight, if the dead aren't in heaven or hell now, as we saw, where are they? They're where? They're in the grave. They're in the grave. Jesus said in John 5, verse 28, 29, behold, the day is coming when all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come out. Some to the resurrection of life, which takes place when Jesus comes. The rest, the condemnation, the resurrection of condemnation, which takes place at the end of 1,000 years. Everybody with me so far? Makes sense so far? We're just putting the Bible together tonight. We're taking the passages that speak on this and putting them together. And I know that there are others, the rich man of Lazarus, and I'm going to get to that. I'm going to get to it. And just keep hanging on, and we're going to answer everything that seems to contradict what I'm sharing with you, and we'll answer it intelligently from the Bible. Sound fair tonight? All right. Number 8, is hell a hot spot in the center of the earth right now? Well, Revelation 20, verse 9, when hell does occur at the end of the 1,000 years, it says they went up on the breadth of the what? The earth. What is the breadth of the earth? What's another word for the breadth? It's the surface of the earth, the breadth of the earth, and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, and the fire came down from heaven out of God and did what? It devoured them. And so the Bible says that the breadth of the earth is the location for hell. So is hell down in the center of the earth? What do you think? It's not. Did that brother dwell down into hell and heard all those people screaming? No, he's probably hearing some kind of gases emitting or something. I don't know what he heard, but it wasn't people. And so hellfire will occur actually on the earth, not down inside the earth. Number 9, what is the fate of the wicked? How long do they suffer punishment in hell? Now, this is one where people get very confused today, friends, very confused. And this is one where some of you might say, well, that's not what I've always been taught, but bear with me to the end, and I think it'll make perfect sense to you. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28, don't fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both what? Soul and body in hell. So the Bible says that God, Jesus said, that God will destroy both what? Soul and body in where? In hell. He says that very clearly. And so is what does that word destroy? What does that mean exactly? What does the word destroy mean? It means to bring something to an end, right? Bring it to an end. Malachi chapter 4 and verse 1, Scripture says, for behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly, will be what? Well, we will be stubble. What is stubble? What is it? It's just like a substance. It's just like dirt, right? You just ashes. Look at this. And the day is coming which shall do what, friends? Burn them up, it says. Very interesting, says the Lord of hosts, that will leave them neither root nor what? Nor branch. Now, if you chop down a tree and you just clip it at the ground, what's going to happen to it? It's going to take it a while, but what's it going to do? It's going to grow back, unless it's one of those little weeds, and they just, you clip it, and it, like, you go to sleep and come back the next day, and it's like this tall again, right? These things are frustrating, aren't they? But if you want to get rid of something permanently, what do? You tear it out by the roots, right? God says that on this day, when the wicked shall be burned, it will leave them neither root nor what? Nor branch. Notice verse 3, God says, you shall trample the wicked, for they shall be what, friends? Ashes under the soles of your feet on the day that I do this, says the Lord of hosts. Now, I don't know of any other time in history when God did this to the wicked. Now, there were people that were burned and so forth, but God's speaking generally here about all the wicked. He says the day is coming, and that day would be that day from Revelation 20, the final day of judgment, that the wicked shall be ashes under the soles of your feet. Look at this, Psalm 37, verse 20, God says, the wicked shall what, friends? They shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord, like the splendor of the meadows, shall vanish. Into what? Into smoke they shall vanish away. But what about the devil? Won't he be in charge of hell? How many of you have ever heard this before? The devil will be in charge of hell. He'll be down there, and he'll be cranking up the temperature, and he'll be taking his pitchfork and rolling people around in that fire and just laughing. Ha, 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 ha. And he's got his pointy horns and his pointy tail, and he's just in charge of hell. Now, let me ask you something. Does God love the people that will actually go to hell, yes or no? Does it make sense that the one who is his greatest arch enemy, he would then turn around and put him in charge of that? What do you think? I don't think so. the one whom hates our souls more than any other, you're telling me as a punishment or as a reward, God's going to put him in charge of inflicting the judgment and the penalty upon the wicked. What do you think? No, I don't think so, friends. You know where that idea came from? It came from the Dark Ages, and our friends, the Roman Church, the Roman Catholic Church, invented that idea to actually scare people, as we talked about last night, into buying those indulgences. That's where it came from. That's the very short version. I could give you the more sophisticated version, but we don't have time. So it doesn't make sense that God would do that. What does the Bible say? Revelation 20, verse 10, it says, the devil who deceived them, he was what? Cast into the lake of fire and what? Brimstone. So is Satan in charge of hell? What do you think? No, he's actually going in there himself. In fact, Jesus said that that hell was not made for us, but it was created for the devil and his angels. Hell is not intended for you and I, although many people will be there. It was actually intended for Satan and his angels. Look at Ezekiel 28. You remember, I think it was night 3 we talked about this chapter. How many of you remember that? It's been a while. But in Ezekiel 28, you go back and read the whole chapter. God's talking about Satan here. He says, therefore I brought fire from your midst, and it what? It devoured you, and I turned you to ashes upon the earth. God's speaking to Satan, and he says, the day is coming when you will actually be turned into what? Into ashes. And he says, you have become a horror and shall be no more for how long? Forever. Why would God reward the devil for all of his actions by putting him in charge of burning the wicked for all eternity? That's a reward. That's exactly what he'd have pleasure doing. I don't think God's so foolish, do you? Because the Bible says that he's going to receive his punishment as well, and he will be turned into ashes, just like in Malachi it said about the wicked. There's that verse, Matthew 25, 41. Jesus said, the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. So the wicked will be consumed, burned up, and turned into ashes, the scripture says. It says it in multiple places, and I didn't even show you all the places that it says it. Romans 6, 23 says, the wages of sin is what, friends? It's death, but the gift of God is what? Eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let me ask you this question tonight. Use your intelligence, look at the scripture, and you tell me tonight. If the wicked are burning in hell for all eternity, and I know all the verses that say forever and ever, and I'm going to run through those quickly tonight. We'll be done. Don't worry. We've got time. I know those verses, and I'm going to come to them. But just think about that. Just put those on a shelf for a second and think about this, and we'll come back to it. If the wicked are burning forever and ever, what does that say about the character of God? For 70 years-ish of life on this earth, I don't think it says much about him, does it? Even evil people, even atheists, I'm not saying all atheists are evil, understand, but even people who have virtually no morality find that to be repulsive. But look at this. The wages of sin is what? Death. If the wicked burn forever, think about this, is that eternal life, yes or no? Think about it. If the wicked burn eternally, forever, is that eternal life? Yes. It is not pleasant, eternal life, but it is eternal life. Are you with me? The Bible says that the wages of sin is what, friends? It's death. In fact, we call it, the Bible calls it in Revelation, the second death, right? But he says the gift of God is eternal life. There's only one group of people that are living forever, and that is who? The righteous. Think about the most famous verse in all the Bible, friends. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten what? Son, and I'm just putting the main points here, and whoever believes in him would not what? Perish, but have everlasting life. The word perish doesn't mean to continue on. It means to what? Come to an end. The Bible is clear about this, friends. So if the wages of sin is burning in hell for eternity, think about this. Then did Jesus really pay the penalty for our sin? He would have to also do what? Burn in hell forever. But he suffered the second death by which the wicked will also suffer at the end of time. So what is the fate of the wicked? These are in your notes. The wicked will die. The wicked will perish. The wicked will be burned up according to these passages. The wicked will be utterly consumed. This is Old and New Testament. The wicked will be turned into ashes. The wicked will be as though they had not been. Satan will be totally destroyed, the Bible says. So Scripture is clear, friends, from A to Z, front to back. How long does hellfire last? Number 10, does it last for eternity? So the question tonight is this. What does the Bible mean when it uses the expression everlasting destruction or eternal fire? People have taken that phrase to mean burning for how long? Forever. But what does the Bible mean? I'm not going to put my own opinions here tonight. I'm going to use the Bible to decipher itself, okay? In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, it says, "Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained what? Eternal redemption." Now notice that. So is Jesus constant, when it says eternal, is he constantly going back in over and over again forever, doing that again and again because it says it's eternal? Is he doing that, yes or no? No, he did it how often? Once. But the result of his redemption is how long? It's eternal. Does that make sense tonight? Okay, now let's look at another one. Of the doctrine of baptisms, Hebrews 6:2, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and eternal what? Judgment. Does that mean that God sits upon his throne over and over again with his gavel, judging for all eternity? Yes or no? No. But the results of redemption and the result of judgment will be what, friends? It will be everlasting. Now let me show this to you once again from the Bible here. Jude 1:7, it says, "As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of what? Eternal fire." Okay, you see that? So there's the phrase where it talks about eternal fire being brought upon Sodom and Gomorrah. Question today, if eternal fire is burning forever, should not Sodom and Gomorrah still be burning? Are they? No, but let's see what the Bible says. 2 Peter 2, verse 6 says that God, in turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into what, friends? Ashes. Condemn them to destruction. Think about that. And making them, notice this, making them a what? An example of those who would afterward live ungodly. So those who are afterward would be those alive today who will be judged at the end of time, would it not be? And he says that they are an example of what will happen to those in the future. Is that beginning to make sense, yes or no? So an eternal fire is one whose effects or results are eternal. Once those people go into ashes, they're not coming back. The result is eternal. An everlasting punishment is one punishment whose effects are eternal. It's not everlasting punishing, it's everlasting punishment. It happens, and then the results are eternal. Very clear. The Bible says they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is what? Destruction, the Bible says. Jesus says, Matthew 7:13, "For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction." What about, last thing here, what about the phrase forever and ever? The Bible says in Revelation 14, "He will be tormented with fire and brimstone, and the smoke of their torment ascends for how long? Forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night." So the question is this. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying here. But does the Bible, when it says forever, could it be that it's not always, depending upon the context, it's not always referring to eternity? Let me show you that from the Bible. Jonah 2:6, he says, I went down to the moorings of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed about me, how long? Forever. Now, what event is he talking about? Being swallowed by the whale. And he says, I was down there for how long? Forever. But how long was he really there? 3 days and three nights, right? And then the whale spit him out. You've said it before. You go to Meijer, and it's on a Friday afternoon, and you're trying to get out of there. And there's a line backed up to the clothes section. You say, man, I stood in line forever. But you didn't really, did you? You were there for a certain amount of time. Forever in the Bible can also be translated until the end of the age or until the end of a specific amount of time. There's actually multiple examples of this in the Bible. I won't show them all tonight. But actually, 56 times in the Bible, the phrase forever is referred to something that has already ended. Very interesting. So the Bible says that the punishment at the end of for the wicked is the second death, not lasting forever. Not lasting forever. You know, friends, people are repulsed when they think about Adolf Hitler and what he did during World War II. How much more the character of God, friends, to do such a thing like that. Now, does that diminish God's justice, yes or no? Does it diminish His justice to not burn people for eternity? It doesn't, does it? It actually makes it greater. It actually makes it greater. I'm going to slip past that. But Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 23, God says, "Do I have any pleasure at all that the wicked should die?" says the Lord God. Does he have any pleasure in it? And not that he should turn from his ways and what, friends? And live. For I have no pleasure in the death of one who dies, says the Lord. Therefore, turn and what? Live. It's the mercy of God tonight, friends, that bids us to turn and live. Amen? He wants us to live. There is one hell. Some people say, well, you don't believe in hell. No, I just believe in one hot enough to get the job done. I believe in hell tonight. I can assure you that. There will be hell. Just one hot enough to get that job done. And God will finally make an end of sin. What will he do once his righteous justice makes an end of sin and destroys it forever? The Bible says that he will create a what? New heavens and a new earth. He creates that new earth out of the ashes of the old earth. And that will be the place that we dwell forever. And the Bible says, I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. And they shall be his people, and God himself will be their God. So God will move the capital of the universe down to planet earth, and he will restore it. And that's where we will live for all eternity. Friends, tonight, is there anything in this life worth hanging on to miss out on that new heaven and that new earth? Is there any commandment worth breaking to continue in sin against God and to find ourselves on the outside of that city? That'll be one of the most trembling days of all of history, the day when every person will stand before God and give an account. Some will be on the inside of the city. Others will be outside of the city. And friends, tonight, it would be my prayer that each one of us would find ourselves on the inside of that city. How many of you tonight want to say, I want to be on the inside of that city? Friends, tonight there's only one way. That's to turn your life completely over to the Lord Jesus Christ. And He is calling each one of us tonight to surrender our lives to Him in every way, to honor Him with our ways, to keep His commandments, to live solely for Him, and to give our lives unreservedly for His kingdom. Have you made that choice tonight? Have you made that choice? I just want to make a special invitation tonight, friends. We don't want to be on the outside of that city. And I'm not trying to scare anybody. I'm just trying to help us see the reality of that moment in time when it will be too late to make a decision. But Jesus invites us to make a decision today. Maybe there's somebody here tonight who says, Lord Jesus, I need to make that decision. Lord Jesus, I need to be one with you. I need my life to be consecrated to you. And you want to say, Lord Jesus, tonight I make that decision today. It may be that you're wrestling with that issue. I don't know what it is. An addiction. Wrestling with the concept of the Sabbath. But you see it from the Bible and you say, Lord Jesus, I want to be committed to you. I'm willing to take a stand tonight. I'm willing to say, Lord, I give you my life. Maybe tonight, friends, you need to make that decision to be baptized or rebaptized. I don't know what your circumstance is. But if that's your decision tonight, you want to say, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you through baptism. Would you just stand wherever you are? Maybe you've already made that decision, but you haven't had it yet. You just want to make that decision tonight. Is there anybody here tonight that says, I'd make that decision? It may not be right away, but it may be in the future. But you're making that decision tonight to yield to Jesus. Say, I want to be baptized. Is there anyone here tonight that says, I'll make that decision. I'll stand for Jesus. Just stand wherever you are, and the Lord will bless you tonight. Anyone? Maybe everybody's already made that decision. All right. Maybe tonight you say, Lord God, I'm just surrendering to you. I don't know what my situation is going to be, but I'm surrendering to you. I'm giving you my life. Would you stand? Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else tonight? You don't have to stand if you don't want to. It's not pressure. The Lord may speak to your heart. He may be saying, lay down that issue to me. Come to me. I'm following you. I'm following you, Lord. Amen. God bless you. For those of you tonight, if you want to be on the inside of that city, would you all just stand with us as we close for prayer this evening? Father in heaven, tonight we praise your holy name and we give you thanks, Lord, that we will find ourselves on the inside of that city. We make that decision tonight to give ourselves to you. We ask your blessing to be with us, Lord, and to draw close to our hearts in a very special way. Seal those decisions tonight through the power of your Holy Spirit and make us ready, O Lord, as you give us more of your Spirit, make us more like Jesus each day. This is our prayer tonight. In his name we ask. Amen. God bless you tonight, friends. Monday night, tomorrow off, Revelation's Temple of Glory. God bless you tonight. We'll see you Monday.